In the last video, we looked at the operations we can do on bivectors. We came up with three operations: finding the magnitude, scaling, and adding. However, these are the same operations that we have for vectors. We saw in a previous video that anything that acts like vectors in an algebraic sense is called a linear space. Does this mean that bivectors form a linear space? That is what we will look at in this video. This video is a part of From Zero to Geo, a series where we formulate geometric algebra, an incredibly powerful branch of mathematics, from the ground up. To determine if bivectors form a linear space, we need to recall what a linear space is. A linear space is a set where we can add and scale elements, with addition and scaling satisfying these conditions. We know how to add and scale bivectors, so are these statements true for bivectors? Now, you may have noticed that the equations for a linear space don't include any statements about magnitude. While the notion of magnitude is not necessary for a set to be a linear space, I'll add some statements about the magnitude to the list of statements we will prove in this video. Similar to the video on the algebra of vectors, try to prove these statements yourself first. It may be difficult to prove some of these geometrically, especially in 3D, but I would suggest trying as much as you can. Please pause the video and give proving all of these statements your best shot before continuing. Now, you may have run into some problems before you could even get started. First off, some of these equations have negatives or zero in them, and we haven't yet defined what those mean for bivectors. Second, addition seems to work pretty differently depending on if you are in 2D or 3D. Do we have to give different proofs for each dimension? And what about higher dimensions anyway? Let's work through these issues before we move on. First, how do we define the negative of a bivector? Well, negating a vector flips its orientation, so negating a bivector should flip its orientation as well. Nothing fancy here. Now for zero, while it may seem strange, we can define the zero bivector in the same way that we define the zero vector, as a bivector with a magnitude of zero. We can draw this as a point. Now, like with vectors, we can consider the zero bivector to be equal to the zero scalar, so I won't draw the bivector arrow on the zero for the zero bivector. The other issue that we need to deal with before moving on to proving the algebraic properties of bivectors relates to dimension. Addition of bivectors seemed pretty different in 2 dimensions and 3 dimensions, and we haven't even covered the addition of higher dimensional bivectors. How should we go about trying to find geometric arguments when they depend on the dimension? Well, for this video, let's just handle the 2-dimensional and 3-dimensional cases separately, and skip the higher dimensional case for now. Now, you might be wondering, we had 11 properties to prove, and now we're going to have to prove them all in both 2 dimensions and 3 dimensions? So we have to come up with 22 proofs? Well, it turns out that there's a trick we can do in 2 dimensions to make this all a lot easier. In my first video on bivectors, we saw that in 2 dimensions they are pseudoscalars, which means that there is a direct correspondence between 2D bivectors and scalars. We can associate one orientation of 2D bivectors with positive scalars and the other orientation with negative scalars. We can make this description more precise now that we know how to do operations on bivectors. Let's pick a unit bivector, which is a bivector with a magnitude of 1. We can write every other bivector in 2D space as a scalar multiple of this bivector. For historical reasons, I'll call this bivector I. Then the previous 2 bivectors are 4 times I and negative 4 times I. Now, you might be wondering, what orientation should I have? By convention, we pick the unit bivector that goes in the positive x direction and then in the positive y direction. This does mean that the positive orientation is counterclockwise, but that's just how it is. Now, with this description of 2D bivectors, we can find a way to compute bivector scaling and addition. We scale a bivector by just multiplying the coefficient of I by that scalar, and we add 2 bivectors by just adding the coefficients. Notice that this works with bivectors with opposite orientations as well. Thus, we see that not only can we describe a 2D bivector using a single scalar, we can also manipulate 2D bivectors the exact same way that we manipulate scalars. Since scalars satisfy all of these properties, 2D bivectors do as well, meaning that we have now proven all of these properties for 2D bivectors, knocking out 11 of the 22 proofs at once. But it gets better! Consider an arbitrary bivector in 3D space. Bivectors live in a single plane, which is two-dimensional. If we restrict our attention to that 2D plane, this now looks like the 2D case we were just looking at. By doing this, we can treat any 3D bivector problem that only involves a single bivector as a 2D bivector problem. Thus, when thinking of all of these properties in three dimensions, the ones involving only a single bivector can be thought of as two-dimensional. We've already proved the two-dimensional versions of these properties by thinking of 2D bivectors as pseudoscalars, so we also get the 3D versions for free. This leaves only four properties left that we will have to prove in three dimensions. This is actually something that happens pretty often in geometric algebra. When faced with a higher dimensional problem, it can help to reduce the problem to a lower dimension whenever you can. Lower dimensional geometric algebra is significantly simpler than higher dimensional geometric algebra, so doing this can make the problem simpler. So, all that's left for us to do here is to prove these four properties for 3D bivectors. I'm going to reorder these from roughly the easiest to prove to the hardest to prove. So let's get down to business and work through these four problems. First, the commutativity of addition. Here are two bivectors. What does the order of the sum even mean? Well, we could pick some region in space to be the starting point, and to calculate u plus v, we'll put u at that spot. Then, we'll put v on the other side of u to get u plus v. To calculate v plus u, you could just go from that starting point using v first to get v plus u. From this diagram, it looks like the sums are the same, but can we be a little more concrete about it? Notice that when drawing bivectors, we draw the edges as vectors. When adding, the sums share some sides with the sumands, but what about the other sides? Looking at this picture, we can see that this vector is simply the sum of these vectors in the sumands. On the other side, we have the same situation but in reverse. By the commutativity of vector addition, these two vector sums are in fact equal, so the two bivector sums are equal as well, showing that bivector addition is commutative. The next property that we need to look at is this form of the distributive law. Here are two bivectors, and here is their sum. Now, we need to scale each of these bivectors by some scalar. These three bivectors already share a side, so to keep things simple, let's have the scaled bivectors also share this side. This means that to scale the bivectors, we must scale the other sides. Now, geometrically, it looks like the sum of the scaled bivectors is equal to the scaled sum, but just like in the last case, how can we prove it? Again, we can think of the vectors making up the bivectors. The vectors getting added here are the scaled versions of the vectors getting added in the original, so by the distributivity of vectors, their sum is the scaled sum of the original vectors. This means that the bivector produced from scaling the sum is in fact equal to the sum of the scaled bivectors, so this property is true. Now, let's look at what is commonly known as the triangle inequality. Once again, let's draw two bivectors and look at their sum. Since the identity of a bivector does not depend on its shape, I've drawn them as rectangles, which will make calculating the magnitude significantly easier. Thinking of the vectors that make up these bivectors, we can directly find the magnitude of each bivector in terms of the magnitudes of these vectors. We want to see if this is true. To show this, we can factor out the magnitude of C and then cancel it. What remains is just the triangle inequality for vectors, which we already know is true. Thus, the triangle inequality is true for bivectors as well. Now the final bivector identity to look at is the associativity of addition. This one ends up being much more difficult to prove than the last few. For the last few, we generally followed the same pattern. Look at a bivector sum, notice that one side is shared by each bivector, and then for the other sides we can apply the corresponding vector identity. You may think we can do the same thing here for associativity, but there's a problem. While we can use this process for a case like this where each bivector has a common side, in general, three bivectors in 3D space don't have a common side, such as these three perpendicular bivectors. Thus, we are going to have to find a different proof. So, let's pick three arbitrary bivectors that don't all share a side. Before moving on, I'm going to morph the shape of these bivectors into something more useful for our current purposes. First, looking at the planes of these three bivectors, they intersect at a point, so let's move and change the shapes to all be touching that point. Next, since we will want to be adding u and v together and v and w together, let's change the shape of u to match one of the sides of v and let's change the shape of W to match one of the other sides of V. At this point, we just need to somehow calculate these two sums and see if they are equal. Calculating these two sums is going to be pretty difficult, so to help, I'm going to name several of the vectors making up the bivectors here. Let's name this vector on the top of WA, this vector on the top of VB, this vector on the side of VC, and this vector on the side of UD. Let's now calculate the sums. First, this is U plus V. Now, to add it to W, we're going to have to change the shape of one of the bivectors. I'll change W to line up with U plus V. Then, U plus V plus W is this bivector. Before calculating the other sum, let's describe this sum a little more precisely. Notice that this side is A plus B, while this side is C plus D. Thus, we can say that the sum is made from A plus B and C plus D. Furthermore, from this view, the bivector is going clockwise. Now let's do the other sum. First, this is V plus W. Now, to add it to U, we're going to have to change the shape of one of the bivectors. I'll change U to line up with V plus W. Then, U plus V plus W is this bivector. Like before, let's describe this sum a little more precisely. Once again, this side is A plus B, while this side is C plus D. Thus, like in the first case, this sum is made from A plus B and C plus D. Also, like last time, the bivector is going clockwise from this view. Because the two sums are made from the same vectors and have the same orientation, the two sums are equal, so bivector addition is associative. At this point, we have now shown that all of these properties are true for bivectors, at least in 2 and 3 dimensions. Thus, as you might have suspected, bivectors form a linear space. This means that we can use practically all of the things we developed in the last chapter with bivectors, even though those things were originally developed for vectors. We can talk about linear combinations of bivectors, we can talk about the span of bivectors, and we can talk about the linear dependence of bivectors. I don't want to focus too much on all of this in this video, with one exception, bases for bivectors. Just like with vectors, we can describe bivectors in terms of a basis, which enables us to do computations with bivectors. But what does this basis look like? Well, it depends on the dimension. In two dimensions, because bivectors are pseudoscalars, bases only have one element. In fact, what we were doing earlier with writing every 2D bivector as a scalar multiple of I shows us that I on its own is a basis for this linear space. Now, while we do often call this bivector I, there is another name that we often give it that extends to higher dimensions. Remember that we call the standard basis vectors E1 and E2, and they go one unit in the x and y directions respectively. The unit bivector I goes along E1 and then along E2, so we sometimes call this bivector E12. Notice that here, we are using the E notation for a bivector rather than a vector. You can look at the number of subscripts to tell the difference. We could also make a unit bivector by going along E2 first and then E1. We call this bivector E21. Looking at them, you can see that E21 is minus E12, so we need to pick one of them to have a basis, and we usually pick E12. Now in three dimensions, we have more basis bivectors. Let's try to use the standard basis here like we did in 2D. We could try going along E1 and then along E2 to produce E12, we could try going along E2 and then E3 to produce E23, and we could try going along E3 and then E1 to produce E31. We could also go in the opposite directions like before to get E21, E32, and E13, which are the negative of the bivectors we have found already. You can verify that you can't get any other simple combinations of the basis vectors this way, so these three bivectors form a basis for 3D bivectors. Now, while everybody agrees on using E12 and E23 in the basis, there's actually some debate over whether the third basis bivector should be E13 or E31. Using E13 keeps all of the indices sorted, while using E31 is more symmetric in three dimensions. It honestly doesn't really matter which one you use as long as you keep it consistent while working on a given problem. In the future, I'll probably use whichever is most convenient for what I'm talking about, although I'll admit I generally prefer E13 over E31. Anyway, using these bivectors, We can now do calculations with 3D bivectors without needing geometry, so I can finally give you exercises involving them. In fact, let's do one right now. Please perform the following calculations. Again, most of these problems are pretty simple, so I won't be going through most of the solutions here. I'll just show the answers in a moment. If you don't want the answer spoiled, pause the video now. Working through these problems, you should have had no issue doing most of the calculations producing these results. However, when you got to the last one, you might have wondered, how do we calculate the magnitude of a bivector in terms of its components? You may have just used the formula for vector magnitudes without thinking, but the derivation of that formula relied on the Pythagorean theorem, which only applies to lengths, not areas. So how can we do this calculation? Well, let's see if we can derive a formula for this ourselves. Consider two perpendicular rectangular bivectors in 3D space. We can think of them as being made up of three vectors, A, B, and C. Because these bivectors are rectangles, we can write the magnitude of each bivector in terms of the magnitudes of the vectors. Now the sum is also a rectangle, and its sides are made from C and A plus B. Thus, its magnitude is the magnitude of C times the magnitude of A plus B. A and B are at right angles to each other, so we can use the Pythagorean theorem here. We can then pull the magnitude of C into the square root and distribute. Now, each term here is just the magnitude of the original bivector squared, producing this formula. Wait a minute. This looks like the Pythagorean theorem. It turns out that a form of the Pythagorean theorem can be applied to bivectors too. Thus, we can find the magnitude of a bivector using the same formula as that for the magnitude of a vector. Going back to our original problem, upon adding we get this, and then applying this formula, the result is 3. Now throughout this whole video, we have only been focusing on 2 and 3 dimensions. How do bivectors work in higher dimensions? Do they still form a linear space? How do you even add 4-dimensional bivectors? We'll answer these questions in the next video.